Palomita, for your great presentation. I think this this presentation has provided us with another perspective regarding the role of foreign direct investment and its potential to serve a catalyzer in addressing many of the issues that SMEs are facing. Also, the presentation focused on the Indian reality. I believe that this is applicable to all developing economies, and we all face similar problems, so well identified by Madhumita in her presentation. Having said this, I can only say that one of the lessons we have learned is that the adoption of concrete and well-directed policies, such as those presented on the investment side of the equation, can and will improve the insertion of SMEs into GVCs. So thank you very much. Now I would like to introduce Mr. Mohammed Salim Ullah from the Ministry of Industry of Bangladesh. Mr. Salim is a Senior Assistant Secretary of the Ministry of Industry of Bangladesh and has held that position for the past 6 years. He's responsible for formulating strategies and draft policies to boost up industries in the country, serving as an architect of the National Industry Policy 2016. Additionally, it is important to point out that Mr. Salim holds an impressive 3 master degrees in different fields. Mr. Salim, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. From the last session, we have been hearing a lot of things about the policies, the importance of policies in the GBC, successful policies can enhance GBC. Right now, I just will tell you about the story of Bangladesh, how policy can help GBC. Next few minutes, we'll trail on Bangladesh context, the textile and apparel SME, and the global value chain. Actually, I draft policy for my countries, especially the industrial policy. So I will share some of the experiences while we do policy, what are the things that we consider and what are the things are necessary to boost up industry. If you see, Bangladesh is in the global spotlight because of its success, economic success. Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, they have been talking very highly about Bangladesh because of the country's last 20 years maintained a strong GDP growth of 6%+, and also because of this economic growth, from 1990 to 2015, we have come down our poverty level at almost 50%. And why? How could it do that? One of the very important things that support Bangladesh is the textile and apparel industry. That's most commonly says RMG, ready-made garments. We have a very phenomenal growth in the textile and apparel sector, and we are right now the number 2 in the world. And last year, 2017, we had more than $28 billion export, and it is 12% of our total GDP and 83% of total export. So question is, what kind of policy that we have taken? That I want to share. Sometimes whenever I go, I meet my friends or I meet my foreign friends, they ask me, what did Bangladesh do differently that triggered the textile and apparel boom? This is the story that I will tell you right now. For my presentation, I have divided into 2. I'll tell you the general statistics about the textile and apparels. Then I will go for the policy support that we have given to boom this industry. About the SME, almost 90% of our garments industries, we have around 4,822 industries. About 90% are SMEs, and 25% GDP is coming from SMEs. 80 to 85% industrial employment are coming from SMEs, and 99% backward link establishments are coming, especially the textile sector is coming from SME, and 90% of the textile global supply chains are coming from SME. If you see the global major player, China is the number 1 in 2016. We are the number 2 by 6.4%. We export the total markets 6.4% of the total export. Other things, if you see, we have started in 1993 with only $0.31 million export. Today, we have almost $28.669 million export. So, by saying this, I'll go, here are some of the statistics, 2014, 15 and 16. Mostly we export to EU countries, USA, Canada and non-traditional markets. Now I'm going to my point. What are the policy support that we have given to achieve such kind of success? Before we go for the success story, we just to give you some kind of information that what are the factors that act highly on this sector. Mostly, this is a global value chain. Mostly, sourcing opportunities determines on five things. This is the price. Every time the buyer wants to have a thing almost as less as possible, they demand as high as high quality as possible. They think about whether the company has strong capacity or not. They also consider whether they can do it speedily or not, and this, at the same time, the entrepreneurs are interested to take risk or not. These five determiners are very important for R&D sectors. And by this, about these five determiners, we have to think about the direct actors. Say, for example, raw material suppliers, where do we get it? What about the producers? How about the skilled laborers? What are the global buyers are wanting, and what kind of policy should we provide? Now come to the policy issues. Actually, there are three synergic and intrinsic factors that trigger the textile boom in Bangladesh. These are resources, opportunities, and policy decisions. Okay, resources, we have abundant labor force. We have a competitive advantage in producing labor-intensive goods, and we have low-cost energy and natural gas. We have also opportunities like duty-free access to European and US market through MFA and GSM agreements. And also, we just created some kind of mechanism. Now I'm telling it to you. For example, we have the advisory committee. This committee comprises of some entrepreneurs, leading entrepreneurs, academia, think tanks. They always guide us what's going on over the world, global market. And we have some indirect support, such as how to keep our market access continue, how we can get foreign direct investment as much as possible, how we can develop our image, how more we can focus on value addition. And also we have human resource development program. We have policy support to improve textile production. We have also awareness of international quality standard program. And we have introduced successfully all of the companies on the job training program so that our laborers can give better performance day by day. There are some direct measure support that provided by the government. This is at the cash incentives. Lower interest rate, electricity and gas tariff, energy removal of energy crisis, bonded warehouse facilities, and duty-free facilities to import of raw materials. This is an example that for the SMEs, we have another 4% additional cash incentives, and also new product market expansion facilities, and we also give 4% extra facilities to the extra 2% facilities for exporting in EU areas in addition to existing 4% facilities. These are the encouragement support that we did, avoidance of double taxation, income tax exemptions, duty-free facilities on dye and other things. This is the way we create basically two advantages. That's price, attractiveness we have created, and the capacity we have developed. These are the report from JETRO that we are the cheapest production production house in the world. So this is the success of us. Today we have $28 billion export, and we want to take it to $43 billion export by 2021. We have also some challenges, and now we have been working on how to eradicate, remove these challenges. Especially we have lost our GST facilities from the US. And also UK Brexit is also trigger us to make renegotiation, and China is also giving us pressure by reducing price, and also currency depreciation. And our next step is to create and maintain this sustainability. That is why we are now working on ensuring a healthier business environment. We are providing more training to our workers. We are improving social compliance, and we are continuously improving our coordination among the manufacturers, exporters, and importers. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Salim, for your presentation. Well-designed and well-implemented policies have the capacity of bringing not only greater levels of insertion in GVCs, but also positive externalities to all levels of industries and services within an economy, an economic system. Now, it goes without saying that in terms of policy, one size does not fit all. But what has been presented here today by the representative of Bangladesh is a great insight for the potential and direction of what industrial policy should be doing. Now, last but not least, I would like to introduce Mr. Sachin Chhabre from India Bombardier Transportation. Mr. Chhabre, is correct the pronunciation, is the head of procurement and supply at India Bombardier Transportation. He currently leads all procurement and supply chain activities for India across manufacturing sites, projects, and new business opportunities. Prior to Bombardier, Mr. Chhabre worked in GE for over 11 years across different countries and businesses.
Thank you, Vivian, and very good afternoon and good evening to all of you. Vivian has given me a pretty difficult task. Last section during the day and the last speaker for the day. So I'll try to kind of keep all of you alive. As she introduced, I work for Bombardier. So people who don't know Bombardier, it is not a very consumer-driven name. So we'll spend a few minutes what Bombardier is, what we do, just to earn my bread and butter. As an overview about the company, we are about a $17.5 billion organization headquartered out of Canada. There are only two products that we make, aircrafts and trains. So it's all variety of trains, whether it is metros, locomotives, high-speed trains. And from an aircraft standpoint, we have dominance in the private jets, but we also make commercial aircrafts. Over 53,000 employees spread across different 60 plus countries. That's what we do. And in India, predominantly what we have is mainly the transportation business. We do sell aircrafts in India, but that's all imported coming in out of Canada. So, giving a little snapshot only on the transportation business, some statistics here. So we move about 500 million passengers a day. Over 1 lakh train cars are in service on a daily basis, which are made by Bombardier. And we've got presence in over 60 countries and with over 200 cities that we are operating in. As far as the portfolio goes, from a transportation standpoint again, we probably got the broadest portfolio in the industry. So we've got competitors, not naming them, I don't want to do free marketing for my competitors here, but we can certainly say that with 200% confidence that we've got the broadest portfolio. Whether it is vehicles, transportation systems, services, rail control solutions, you talk about anything in the transportation space, we've got it, and it's state-of-art technology there. Coming to India, as a commitment to the country, we've kind of made huge investments. Our major factories are all based out of Gujarat, Baroda, in and around Baroda, not exactly in Baroda. It's about like 20 kilometers one side and the other is 10 kilometers on the other, second side. So that's where we started our first Delhi Metro car production. That's the biggest site that we have in India. And people who are from Delhi or who travel to Delhi often, and if they've used metro facility in Delhi, which has practically changed the landscape of Delhi, we would say we command about 60 plus percentage of that market for the Delhi Metro. We do propulsions for Indian Railways and we are partnering Indian Railways for various other activities. So the first technology transfer for Indian Railways was done by Bombardier in the 1980s. Sometime. Not spending too much time on this, kind of since we talk of value chain is not just manufacturing, it also includes services, and many a times we start limiting our thoughts when we talk of value chains related to manufacturing. So from a services standpoint, we are doing a lot of IT work, not just for Bombardier India, but also the whole IT, since we are so-called the IT capital of the world as a country, we are doing this IT work for practically majority of the global sites of Bombardier. So we've got facilities in Baroda, we've got a huge engineering center in Hyderabad. So IT, engineering, kind of where all that intellectual capability is required, where India is pretty good in. We're doing all that work and it's contributing at the end of the day for the economy. We've got some successes in the country. So some statistics, but I just mentioned about that. Again, I know it's the last session, so I'm not going through every detail of those numbers. So we've got about roughly 800 cars for Delhi Metro operating today at any given day. The biggest one is we are doing an equivalent size order for Delhi Metro, which is the customer is out of Australia. So we are doing all that manufacturing out of our facility in Savli in Gujarat, in Baroda. So that's pretty much a similar size order. 75 train sets that we are doing out of India. It's a fully export oriented unit. And we'll talk about that whole value chain just in a minute on that project in particular. Yes, so we were talking about this, which is we're not just focusing only in India. It's again in India for India, in India for the world. So Delhi Metro is the project which is typically driven by in India for India. And then we have got a customer in Australia, which is Queensland. So we are doing that, the whole activity, like in India for the world. And that's the whole trains that we are doing, but we also do a lot of bogies sending all across the world from our facilities here in India. The focus is typically on the indigenization here. We kind of are big promoter of the Make in India concept, which is being promoted by our Honorable Prime Minister here. So in continuation of that same spirit, we do import stuff, but again, the objective is we want to maximize the local content and a huge focus on the supplier development locally and indigenization of whatever we can do out of India. You see the major investments there and some of the expansions that we are doing. And typically some of the major suppliers who've invested for us, they are the global partners for Bombardier, who've kind of followed us here in the country and made those investments in pursuance with the developing economy that we have and the commitments that we are making in continuation to that same spirit. Overall, as a supply chain, the focus is, it's very similar to what our colleagues or our friend from the United Nations talked about. It's a global central procurement and supply chain organization. We have some specific standard objectives all across the organization, and India is just a subset of that whole theory. The objectives are to reduce the cost, enhance the profitability, and keep the cash positive situation for the company. I'll kind of give you this as a live example, what we do. This is the project that I was talking of that we are shipping out of Baroda to Australia. What you see is the final product going from India to Australia, but there are components that we are sourcing from practically all across the world. And I wanted to kind of bring that here because it's a relevant forum which shares or describes the opportunity that we have, because we do want to localize and indigenize all of these components. For this particular project, which is a multi-billion dollar project for us, it's still about 35-40% that we are importing. And that's all opportunity. That was the whole objective. So I didn't share the numbers. I wanted to keep that confidential. It's more of a proprietary information for us. But that's purely an opportunity which is available. A picture is worth 1,000 words. If you see the flow, it goes like horizontally. That's when the train is getting manufactured in the site. The second picture is when it's getting packed, getting onto the trucks. Each and every truck is leaving the factory there. And then you see that NYK picture, that's that one car getting into the container. And finally, the finished train running on the tracks in Australia. So it's clear description of that whole value chain. We're sourcing the components from all across the world. The concept is simple. It's best cost sourcing, not low cost sourcing. So that's the motto that we work with. That's the opportunity that we really wanted to share here, and we'll be more than happy to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chaudhary. You have presented us with a different perspective, taking into consideration that Bombardier is a global player, but your insights in terms of the evolution of the business model from its core investment in India and then from India to the world is quite exceptional. The latter taking into consideration that within not only its internal expansion but also external expansion, they have incorporated local film in their value chain. I don't know if we have time for questions or we are, well, we have time for two questions. We are running out of time. I don't know if you, any of you have any questions for...
My name is Satish Pathak. It's a question specifically for you. What are the criteria or Invest India specifically look for so that startups can bring their proposals and get the things propelled forward regarding foreign investment?
So within Invest India, we have the Startup India Hub that is also taken care by Invest India along with the Make in India campaign. So both are housed under Invest India. So from a startup point of view, there is, you know, really the most basic criteria that we look for, which, you know, the details are available on Startup Hub, which you can go and take a look. But we are more than happy to connect to see how we can help you and take you forward with respect to either connecting you to the foreign retailers, foreign investors, or with the respective funding and angel investors. Whatever support that you look for from a startup point of view, Startup India team is right here available to help you. You can get into Startup India Hub or you can connect with me and we can take it offline.
Yeah, that is needed because we are already a DIPP recognized innovation startup and it's a global impact innovation I would be needing to discuss.
Great. So Invest India sits under DIPP. We are the non-profit that sits under DIPP and we report into the Ministry of Commerce eventually. So more than happy to connect to today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
My name is Salima Patel. My question is for Madhumita. Actually, you are saying that we should encourage the foreign retailers in our market. So will it not affect the Indian wholesale exporters?
So that's a perceived threat which has existed.
Yes.
So that is one of the slides which I had shown. If you notice that the organized retail has consistently increased from 2000 to 2005 to 2010. Along with that, the unorganized market has also equally increased. What is happening is the entire pie is increasing where the demand is much more now for more players, both organized and unorganized players, to compete eventually. And I would like to take a few examples where you have somebody like a Walmart, which has introduced a Mera Kirana program, and Amazon, which has introduced a Project Udan, IKEA, which has come up with the Disha program. What are all of these programs is basically to connect with the SMEs, to directly source from them, help them to, you know, when you directly source it from them, all the logistic cost, etc., the SMEs don't have to pay. They have to just give the quality of the product. Second is, if an SME in the absence of these people are able to sell only in that locality. Let's take an example of a craft person in Assam. Is able to sell that particular craft only in that area of Assam and not outside because he or she cannot afford to go out. Versus with the introduction of them and directly sourced, or through an online platform like eBay, Flipkart, etc., the entire globe becomes their market. So this is, and the population is now 1.5 billion and we are going to become a $4 trillion consumer market by 2025. So with the larger pie increasing, it's only more players that have the opportunity to compete. So we don't see a possibility of the organized retail eating into the Kirana stores or affecting the unorganized retail in India.
That's true, but again, there'll be a section of labor which has been oriented for the different countries, right? The country people will have some retail packing, and that even labor is again going to be distracted, right?
No, if you see that today, one of the things is, yes, MSME sector does employ a lot of people. But again, it is unorganized employment. But now when say a delivery boy in a kirana store, he gets only his monthly salary of whatever the amount is. But in case he becomes the delivery boy of a distribution center of an organized retail, he is in the payroll of a company. So apart from his monthly salary, he gets other benefits like health insurance, a provident fund, and a secured job that he is in. And also he's open to more training and skill development for him to improve further. So that's the difference that we are trying to see between what a particular delivery boy, as an example, will get in a organized retail versus an unorganized retail.
Any other question?
Yeah, my question is to you, Mr. Sachin Chhabra, sir. You were speaking about sourcing from India too, right? The components. Are you willing to source from an Indian startup company? And if so, what kind of support can you give a startup?
The honest answer is, am I willing to buy from a startup? Yes. If you ask me, will there be a support? I doubt.
Thank you, sir.
I just want to add a sub-question to that, saying that fine, you don't want to do any mercy is a different issue. It may be your policy because you might be sticking to some qualities and standards. But that is why the value chain matter comes in picture, whereby these SMEs can integrate together and bring the products to the expectations of your standards, and then they are given priority if those standards are met. So if that is a twist in a policy and approach, then it can help the value chain with the SMEs. If an individual trying to meet everything what you expect might not be possible, but a couple of startups, or because startups, they don't born like just out of thought. There is lot of innovation and lot of other efforts are inside, then only such innovation startups come up. So definitely they have some value to offer you. So having these people together and bringing the standards to your expectations, then would you give the preference to such value chain together? That is the question.
Let me try and rephrase my answer. So if you ask me preference, again, I would say no. But if will I be open to that idea? I will be very open to that idea. Absolutely open to that idea. I will treat them at par with anybody else. But again, will I be supportive? Will I be giving a preference? No.
Government of India already has put a norm to procure at least 20% of the total procurement from the SMEs, and the PSUs and all other organizations are following those norms. So does it apply to your kind of an organization?
Not to my knowledge.
We had been participant of the National Vendor Program, and it was all shared during that.
It will be a learning for me.
Sir, support, when they ask for support, any company, small company, there can be various types of support like technical support, economic support, or financial support. I think technical support should be always open.
Okay, so technical support is a normal process we give to any supplier that we develop.
Yeah.
So that's a part and parcel of the process. We do that at par with any supplier.
Thank you.
That's absolutely given. Now, if the support comes in terms of financials or stuff like that, that becomes a problem.
Thank you.
Thank you for all the presentations and great Q&As. I just would like to express that in terms of the insertion of a country in GCs, there is no one size fits all. But there are certain common factors such as a well-designed public policies, industrial policy, investment attraction policy, trade policy, etc. But however, as always, to find a solution, one must identify the problem. If not done well, there is no policy available that will prevail. So thank you for to the speakers and for the organizers, and see you later.
Thank you, Viviana. Before we call it a day, we have three more awards to be presented. I would request Madam Rupa Naik, Senior Director at MVIRDC Mumbai, to please do us the honors. We have given 6 awards already through the day, and tomorrow there will be a few more, altogether 20 awards for outstanding performing companies in the MSME sector. This goes to Phoenix International, awarding under the category Women Entrepreneur. This goes to Madam Seema Parke. She is the company head of Phoenix International. This is a Mumbai-based international company founded by a woman entrepreneur, Seema Parke, in 2010. It is an FSI certified manufacturer and exporter of agricultural commodities such as tamarind, turmeric, groundnut, sesame seeds, natural food color, synthetic food color, and synthetic flavor. Congratulations to you. The next awardee, Shubham Starch Care Private Limited, awardee under the category Manufacturing, and we have Mr. Akash Agarwal, Director of Business Development, to receive the award. Shubham Starch manufactures modified starch for paper, textile, food, pharma, and construction chemical industry. A team of research scientists work on import substitution in modified starches industry. The company exports customized products to several countries. Congratulations to you. MAC Design under the category Services. And we have Mr. Mayank Shah, Chief Innovation Officer, MAC Design, along with Abhinandan Singh, Chief Marketing Officer, to receive this award. MAC Design is one of the best system integrators and software providers in Central India. They specialize in various domains such as software solutions, education solutions, industrial solutions. Security solutions and surveillance systems, and provide services to global clients. Congratulations to you too. Thank you all the experts on the day, you audience members. Thank you for being a wonderful audience, and I'm sure that you will agree it was an absolutely fruitful and fulfilling day.